Cobb Webb theorem and simple theory of price determination, part 1. In this lesson, let us try to understand the Cobb Webb model by observing how a market moves from disequilibrium to equilibrium or from instability to stability. Already, we have studied the same phenomenon using the static approach. A quick glance of it will do a lot good to us. Look at this graph. The market is in equilibrium at E, where demand is equal to supply. Suppose there is excess demand in the market at 10 rupees price. Since demand is greater than supply, buyers bid a higher price by moving up along the demand curve. As the price moves up, the sellers will expand the supply by moving up along the supply curve. Both will reach point E. The market is back in equilibrium. Similarly, when there is excess supply at 30 rupees, the sellers will try to sell more by reducing the price and moving down along the supply curve. The buyers also expand their purchase by sliding down along the demand curve. The market will be back in equilibrium at E. In this analysis, what is to be noted is the market moves directly from a state of disequilibrium to equilibrium. The adjustment is instantaneous. Nothing happens in between. Hence, it is called a static approach. But Cobb-Webb model says before reaching stability from a state of instability, the market has to make a lot of adjustment in terms of price and quantity. Thus, Cobb-Webb model is dynamic in its approach. In this respect, it drastically differs from static model. The main utility lies in its becoming a tool in the hands of the policymakers regarding market intervention by the government. With this brief introduction, let us go inside this model. At the very outset, let me make one thing very clear. According to Cobb-Webb model, the current period demand is the function of current period price. But this is not true in case of supply. Current period supply is the function of previous period price. If there is a change in price in the current period, supply will adjust in the next period and not immediately. This is true in case of agricultural products and animal rearing. Let us use wheat market in our analysis. Let us assume to begin with the market for wheat is in equilibrium. The equilibrium price of wheat is 25 rupees and the equilibrium quantity is 500 units. The demand curve DD represents the normal behavior of buyers. Supply curve SS shows the normal behavior of suppliers. In our analysis, the term normal is used to denote very long run. Okay, in one given year, there was a monsoon failure. Farmers bring only 200 units of wheat to the market. The market is thus disturbed. There arises disequilibrium in the wheat market. Supply can be augmented only after the next harvest. For this, the market has to wait for 1 year, that is next period. Let us examine what happens in the present period or period 1. In period 1, supply is fixed at 200 units. Given the demand curve DD, heavy competition among the buyers pushes up the wheat price to 40 rupees. Sellers' behavior is governed by the supply curve SS. Encouraged by this higher price of wheat, the farmers increase the wheat output. They supply 700 units in period 2. Thus, the supply of wheat in period 2 is function of the price in period 1. Right. What happens after the adjustment of price and quantity? Again, the market is in disequilibrium. Supply in period 2 is fixed at 700 units. Given the demand curve DD, the buyers buy wheat at 10 rupees in the same period. In the next period, that is period 3, the farmers produce and supply 300 units of wheat. Supply being fixed at 300 units, given the demand curve DD, the buyers buy the output at 30 rupees. Once again, reinvigorated by the rise in price from 10 rupees to 30 rupees in period 3, the farmers produce more and supply 600 units in period 4. You know, the buyer's behavior is governed by the demand curve DD. They buy this output at 20 rupees. The price in period 4 makes the farmers to supply 400 units of output in period 5. Okay, if this process continues in this manner, at last equilibrium will be reached. But how? Look at the oscillations. The price oscillates from 40 rupees to 10 rupees, from 10 rupees to 30 rupees, and from 30 rupees to 20 rupees. The quantity also oscillates from 200 units to 700 units, 700 units to 300 units, from 300 units to 600 units, and 600 units to 400 units. The range of oscillations diminish and move towards stable equilibrium. In other words, oscillation is damping. Our conclusion is that when there is damping oscillation, the market is sure to reach stability or stable equilibrium. The given cobweb model is a perfect example for dynamic equilibrium or stability because cobweb theorem traces the path of price and quantity adjustment from a state of disequilibrium to a state of equilibrium period by period. The first part of my lesson on cobweb theorem and simple theory of price determination is over. But more is there for you to know. Visit part 2 of this lesson. Don't be a big loser by missing that lesson. The link is given in the description. We shall meet again.